Hi everybody, it's Peter Zellum's Griniflix Adventure 8 and welcome to another video. Today's video is about Nikon. I was talking to my friend who's a keen photographer, well, was a keen photographer, not so keen anymore, and his old Nikon gear has just been sitting in a bag. So I thought, let's review that and see whether that's a good setup for anyone new getting into photography. You might be using an iPhone like I am right now to do videoing and stills. And you might want to learn more about f-stops and apertures and shutter speeds and ISOs and things like that. So, is there a good camera to get started? Well, maybe the Nikon D200 is a good way to get started. So here it is. I have the Nikon D200 and I've got a 50mm f1.4D lens on it. So I'll take some shots around the harbour here. And as a comparison, I've got my Nikon D500. And I've also got an old lens on here, and 50mm f1.4 AIS lens. And quite a well used and well battered lens. And we'll take a few shots and we'll be able to compare the files. The difference in these two cameras is that the D500 is a 20 megapixel camera and the D200, I think, is a 10 megapixel camera. I'll have some details there. And there's a few other things, operation things that are different, which I'll be able to review, go through with you back in the studio. But I'll take some shots around here, around the harbour. I'll shoot 100 ISO wherever possible and similar apertures, and I might swap these lenses around also between the D500 and the D200, and then we'll go into Lightroom, have a look at the shots. I'll be shooting raw. All right, so let's take some shots. Okay, well, we're back out of the cold. Whew, at least it's warmer in here. All right, so we're out there with the Nikon D200 and also the D500 and the 50mm old AIS lens and 50mm f1.4D lens. So I did swap them around in Lightroom, have a look at the photographs as well. What else can I tell you straight away about these? The form factor of these two cameras is very similar. There's a big difference in price, close to 10 times more for the D500 compared to the D200. Can you get shots that are as good, almost as good, as the D500? Yes, there's a difference in megapixels. End of the day, it's all about the lens, isn't it? Depending on how you're presenting your photographs, you may well find that the D200 does a pretty damn good job. One other big difference you'll notice between the two cameras is the ISO rating. So the ISO on the D500 goes a long, 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 long way. The D500 goes right up to 51,200. And then there's another stop on top of that, which you can actually, another two stops, you can actually, three stops, four stops, five stops, another five stops on top of that, which is a ridiculous amount. Not that you would ever use it, but anyway, that's what it can do. And that's probably one of the big differences, is the ISO rating and the sensitivity of the sensor. The ISO that this can go up to is a mere 1600, that's a big difference. 1600, and then you've got high one stop. So you can force 3200 maybe. Yeah, so low light capability of the D500 is so much better than the D200. So that's what you're paying for, is the technology of the sensor. But otherwise, as far as handling is concerned, it's so similar. The advantage of the D500 is the flip out screen. The D200 doesn't have a flip-out screen. What other functions? The D500 is great. It's an outstanding camera. You've got a backlit buttons as well, which you don't have on the D200. Anyway, let's have a look at the photographs and see whether the D200 still stacks up.
Okay, so here are some shots. Now, what I've done, these are the RAW files, and I have done a little bit of color adjustment. If we just go to one of these photographs, see what's happened here. I've increased the exposure slightly, but that's about it. I might have changed the white balance temperature as well in some cases, Because what I did notice with the D200 is that it was giving me a much warmer image compared to the D500. So I've just balanced out the colors as much as possible. There was cloud about the place and the lighting conditions were changing all the time. And you'll see it in these buildings as we go through the photographs. The yellow frames here are with the 50mm f1.4D, the autofocus lens. And the ones in the red are the 50mm f1.4 AIS manual lens. And from the file names here, we've got a 5 there, which is the 500. And we've got the 2 there, which is the D200, so it'd be easy to make the comparisons. To start with, I'll grab this one here, which is the 500, and I've got the AIS lens on there, and the D200 with the autofocus lens. So we'll have a look at both of those. Now, these are still the raw files, and I will eventually go onto the export file that I have as well. So we'll select those two, we'll look at those side by side, and straight away notice a file size difference. We got 5568 by 3712 for the D500, so that's close to 20 megapixel, and a 10 megapixel file here with the D200. So you can see that the image is smaller in this case here when we're doing side by side compared to the image here on the left with the 500. Let's get out of here, because what I'll do is I've exported all these images and created a new JPEG file, but I've actually exported in such a manner that I've created the same pixel size photo for both. So I've increased the pixel size for both to 24 megapixel. If we go to the export files now, then we'll be able to see. If we have a closer look now we notice that we're at 6,000 by 4,000, so 24 megapixel photos in both cases, 6,000 by 4,000. So then when we do zoom in and side by side, we'd be able to see a similar size picture for both. And in this image here, we're using 50mm f2.8 at ISO 100 and 1/3200 of a second. You know, both images come up pretty good. You do notice a little bit more detail here in the D500. But then when we move around, what else do we know? So we're using different lenses. We've got the manual lens on the D500 and the automatic autofocus lens on the D200. In this case here, for this particular photograph, yes, we've got the D500 with more detail than the D200, which you would expect. But there were some surprises. The surprises, I think, are to do with focus. But anyway, let's have a look at some more photos. And what we'll do is have a look at an image where we've got the same lens on both cameras and see what sort of comparison we have. Okay, so we've got the AIS lens at 1.4, shooting at 1.4 on the D500. And then we've got the same shot here on the D200, 1.4. So we select those two photographs, compare them side by side. So we've got the 500 on the left and we've got the 200 on the right, both shot at 1.4 at wide open on the AIS lens. And let's have a look. And this is what I was saying about nailing the focus, and that has a greater impact than the megapixels, I think. So in this case here, I think I didn't quite get the focus right on the 500, and the D200 is actually giving me a better image. Shooting wide open, I've got some chromatic aberration here. The purple fringing from the lens, which is typical of shooting wide open on the 1.4 manual lens. And the D200 is giving me a better image than the D500 in this case, because the focus is wrong on the D500, I'm pretty sure. Having a 10 megapixel sensor versus a 20 megapixel sensor did not provide any advantage here because the focus was wrong. How's that? Yeah, look, the D200 here doing a great job. All right, let's see whether I've got better focus elsewhere. A similar situation, but let's go up a couple of stops to say 2.8. Do side by side. All right, so we've got the D500 on the left, the D200 on the right, and we'll have a closer look. All right, I got the focus right this time with the D500, and I think the focus is okay with the D200 as well. And now we do see the difference with the higher quality sensor on the D500 versus the D200. You can see in the railing here on the D200 and the D500 there. Let's go up here somewhere. So there's the city building. Yeah, so I'm pretty sure I got the focus right in both cases. And now we're seeing the difference in the quality of the sensor, which is, again, what you would expect with the more modern sensor. But it just shows how well the D200 handles the situation as well. It gives you a fantastic image, which then also shows that the D200 is excellent value for money. Anybody interested in getting into photography, that would be a good choice of camera with little expenditure. Yeah, you can see this here in the hand rail here. You can see each one of those little vertical struts there. And they become a bit more blended here in the D200. So that was with the AIS lens. Let's have a look at the autofocus lens. And side by side, so we've got 500 on the left, 200 on the right with the autofocus f1.4D lens. Okay, let's zoom in straight away. And what do we notice? Okay, we've got some green fringing here and we've got some purple fringing there. What I know from past experience with the Nikon lenses, and this is probably typical of all lenses anyway, if you see the purple fringing, it means what you focused on was just beyond this building here, which creates a purple fringing. And this one here on the left, my focus was just towards me more than the building. So the green fringing tends to be the background. The purple fringing tends to be the foreground area. So in both cases, I've missed the focus with the autofocus slightly. And that explains the different fringing that we're seeing. The quality, all right. Well, yeah, well, the D500 is better than the D200. We'll go to another one. What about if we go to F4? We'll get in there. All right. Focus. All right. It just really does show that sometimes manual focus is better than automatic focus. Automatic focus. Okay, the D200, again, didn't quite get the focus there. It has a green fringing here, which means the focus is just short of the subject here. And it got the focus correct here on the 200. And the 200's giving me a much better picture than the 500. Again, it comes back down to focus. If you can nail the focus correctly, you get a better shot, irrespective of how many megapixels you have. Yeah, definitely got the focus better on the D200 in this case than I did on the D500. You can see how fuzzy that is. Let's do maybe F4 on the AIS lens. Let's see how that stacks up. Side by side, 200 on the left, 500 on the right. What do we got? We got both in focus. The manual lens, I think, wins in this case here. And then we really do see, again, the difference in megapixels. Yes, we do get a better image with the 500 compared to the 200. Once you stop down the manual lens to F4, you get rid of a lot of the chromatic aberration. That same picture before, we had that purple fringing at 1.4. We don't have any of that now at F4. And we got a nice sharp image in both cases. Both the 500 and the 200 provides a great shot. And this is zoomed in at 200. If we go back to 100 here, you can see that even with a 10 megapixel image with the 200, you got a great shot. You're getting a great shot out of both cameras, the D200 and the D500. And you can see you can blow these images up as much as you like just by resizing them. How they look, we go to the sign. So there's a D500 and there's a D200. And we zoomed in at 400%. So if you were to make a large print of the D with the D200, you'd have a great shot, irrespective. You could do further editing on both images to bring up even more detail if you wish. Let's see what happens in the shadows. Even the D200 does a pretty good job in the shadows. You would expect the D500 to handle the shadows better, and it does do that. It It's got more detail. All right. I think that's a wrap for this. I'm so impressed with the D200.
Well, I started this video with the expectation that megapixels doesn't really matter that much. It's really to do with whether you can nail the focus or not, and what you can do in post-processing to get the image or the output that you want for however you're going to be using the image. And my conclusion from this video is I was right. Megapixels, yes, they do help. However, focus is more important. Getting that focus and choosing, you know, the type of lens you have and the quality of the lens and getting the focus are the two main important things. And then you can do stuff in post-processing to get the image that you want. Obviously, the more pixels you have, the more you can crop into the photograph as well. So if I was to conclude, okay, what I noticed about these two cameras and particularly the two lenses as well, was that I was more accurate of my focus using manual focus. There's focus assist little dot within the screen as well, so you can get that focus correct. I used autofocus on the D, with this lens, with the 500 1.4D. And if I would have used manual focus on this as opposed to autofocus, then I possibly could have got some more consistent results rather than being slightly short with focus or long with focus. Advantage of the D200 over some of the cheaper Nikon crop sensor cameras is that this has a coupling ring so that you can put the old manual Nikon lenses on it and it's still compatible. You've got a huge selection of lenses that can actually go on the D200, the manual ones and the autofocus ones as well. The cheapest combination of situation would be getting the D200 with the manual AIS 50mm lens. The D200 sells for as little as $100 US on the internet, on eBay, for example. And you're paying 10 times more for the D500. The lens, the automatic focus lens, sells for about $200 secondhand. And you can get the AIS lens for about half that price, for about $100, depending on the condition. It might be a bit scratchy like this one on the outside, but as far as the lens is concerned, it's a great lens. So you can get into some serious photography with the D200 and a manual lens for $200. Isn't that good? Now, of course, there's some differences. Why you pay 10 times more is you've got some extra functionality with the D500. This will shoot at 10 frames per second. It has two card slots. It's got the flip-out screen, much better screen here. And the low light conditions that this can shoot in is spectacular. You can go right up, you can push the ISO to about 3200 on this. So it's basically 1600, and then you can get that extra high one more stop by stretching it or forcing it that way. Whereas the D500 has an incredible ISO rating of 51,000, then you got another five stops on that. You would never use it because the image just deteriorates like anything. Beyond that, you can shoot quite easily up to 25,000 ISO here and still have an outstanding image. All right, so yes, it's worth paying the 10 times more. So if you've got the 200 already and you want to upgrade, the 500 is a great way to do that. If it's a first time into photography for you, then the D200 with a manual 50mm lens would be a great combination for very little expenditure. Chances are if you buy the 200 secondhand, you'll get the battery, you'll get the card. It is a compact flash card like this. There's only one card slot in there. So if you can get the card at the same time, that will save you a lot of money. With the D500, you've got different types of cards. You've got the SD card, like this one. And you've got the XQD card, which is a different type of card again. All right, well, that's it. Great value for money, the D200. Anyone that's got it, I suspect you're still keeping it because, and if you're into photography in a big way, you'd probably keep that and then upgrade to other cameras as well. And this is just the DSLR type cameras with a flip-up mirror. Of course, you can go into mirrorless,
But that's another price bracket again. Well, I hope you found this video interesting. If you did, then give it a thumbs up. I'd really appreciate that. And if it's the first time to my channel, then do subscribe. Press notifications. You'll be notified when the next video is out. Thanks again for watching, and I look forward to seeing you on the next video. Cheers. Bye.